Bars here, they should be developed into the block work, so this bar should go inside the support.
Today we have an exciting topic for all the aspiring structural engineers out there. We will be discussing structural inspections, the importance of conducting a thorough assessment, and I will provide you a comprehensive inspection checklist. But before we dive into the inspection checklist, let's understand why structural inspections are crucial. As a graduate engineer carrying out a site inspection, it's your job to ensure the safety and integrity of the building. By conducting a thorough inspection, you will be able to identify potential issues, maintain the longevity of the structure, and possibly even prevent failures. Now, grab your tape measure, your hard hat and safety boots, and let's go. First and foremost, review the structural drawings and specifications. Understand the purpose and the function of this structure. If it's a big job, your very first inspections can get overwhelming, especially if you're doing it by yourself. And trust me, nothing worse than leaving a site unsure about something you have inspected. So that's the reason you have to review the drawings and know in advance exactly what you will be inspecting. Item number two, make sure you bring a copy of the drawings to the site, and don't forget your inspection book so you can write a report and hand it to the builder. In the inspection report, you will write any rectification works that the contractor has to do before proceeding, or if you're happy with the items inspected, you can just say that all was adequate and approved for whatever it is. You should also write things like ensure cover is maintained during pour or ensure concrete strength as per drawings. Those are comments that you can always have on your inspection report as standard comments. What I personally like doing is to color all inspected items on my iPad so I know what has been done and what the next inspections will be about. And when you get back to the office, don't forget to email the report to the contractor and copy your manager in the email as well. Item number three, footing inspection. Inspection of footings generally includes checking the dimensions, cover, reinforcement size, spacing of bars, and lap length, as I show in this video I posted on Instagram. The cage of the pad footings, the size of the bars, and the spacing. Have a look at the dimensions of the footings. See if the bars are touching the ground or they're properly chaired up. The mesh is continuous past the intersection, and there are N12 L bars lapped with the mesh. Notice how the mesh of the internal beams develops into the pad footings. The starter bars ensure that the load-bearing elements being supported by the footing has starter bars coming out of it. The bearing capacity of the foundation is usually certified by a geotechnical engineer. And before you head off, say good day to the contractor and make sure he knows all about the concrete strength required as per the drawings. Item number four, columns and walls inspection.
You can see the rebars on top. It should be N12 at 400 centers. And then you've got the control joints. Go up there as well and check if the horizontal bars are in place. We'll just have a look at this biscuit here and try to pop them out. Make sure the bars are in there. Make sure everything's clean. Then you just close it.
Firstly, walk the entire area and check the columns and walls dimensions and the main reinforcement. And then on your way back, check the spacing of bars and lap lengths. Make sure the starter bar sticking out for the next level above has enough lap length. Don't forget to check the cover. It must achieve the minimum cover, but remember that too much cover can be problematic for crack control. As a side note, I'll leave a checklist PDF in the description of the video, so if you want to support the channel, just check that out. Item number five, suspended slab inspection. Firstly, walk the entire area checking the supports and edge connections. Ensure all the columns and walls supporting the slab are in place. This might sound obvious, but you would be surprised of how many people get this wrong. Another mistake that you should pay attention when inspecting a suspended slab is to make sure you develop the bars past the face of the support. And I'll show you what I mean by that.
These U-bars here, they should be developed into the block work, so this bar should go inside the support. You cannot stop the bars short here before your support wall.
Check that non-load-bearing walls below have not been built as load-bearing. So you should be able to see a gap between the slab soffit and the wall. Walk the entire area again, checking the thickness of the slab and the main reinforcement. You may want to check the bottom rear first, then top rear, whatever you find easier to maintain your focus. If there are columns and walls over, check the starter bars are suitable. Ensure adequate cover can be achieved at all locations.
Here, make sure you have enough cover in the side. See, doesn't have much cover, so that needs to be fixed. There's a step here. You crank the bar. This bar here is very close. There's not much cover. They're gonna have to cut this one short.
If the engineer specified 20 millimeters cover and you found that on site they have 15 millimeters cover, that's wrong. Fix it. Now if they have 25 millimeters cover, that should be okay. If they have 35 or more, that's not okay. So again, if it is specified 20 millimeters cover, no less than 20, nor much more than 25. That's my rule. If in doubt, talk with your senior engineer. Check the dimensions of bands, reinforcement, legs, spacing, lapping, and if it's a large concrete slab, check the location of the construction joint and if it's as per the drawings. And finally, have that quick chat with the contractor, ask him how his day is going and what concrete strength he is using.
This video is sponsored by ClearCalcs. ClearCalcs is an online structural design and analysis software that helps structural engineers save time and produce better designs. The platform offers calculators to design with timber, steel, cold form steel, and concrete. And the best part about ClearCalcs being cloud-based is all you need to do is go to clearcalcs.com and log in. No installation required. Let's have a look inside the platform. First thing you will notice is that they have a standards library integrated to the website where you can find all the Australian standards. So let's say I want to have a look at concrete structures, that's AS3600. There we go, we have full access to the whole AS3600. Now if you head to projects, create a new project, and then add a calculation, you will have the option to choose codes from Australia, New Zealand, US, Canada, and Euro code. We're going to choose Australia, and then we can design all sorts of beams, columns, footings, retaining walls, connections, and much more. And if you click in one of these calculators, there will be presets to design specific types of beams, which makes the calculations more straightforward. So if you want to save time and produce better designs, ClearCalcs is the perfect tool for you. There will be a link down in the description below and you can start using it for free.
Item number 6, steelwork inspection. Before you start comparing the drawings to the structure on site, walk the entire area, understand the load paths and check if every structural element makes sense to you. Then you go back again, checking the framing and connections. There are no set rules on how you should do that. The way I find easier is to check one item at a time. For example, I check the columns, base plates, and column beam rafter connection. Then I walk back checking the purlings and girds, lapping, spacing, number of bridging, connection to the rafters, connection to the columns. And I would suggest you doing like that in sections for everything you have to inspect. Item number 7, timber framing inspection. Personally, I find this one tricky to explain in a quick video because every builder has a particular way to put a framing together. It's not uncommon you go from site to site and see different types of tie down or connections. So for this one, you really need to make sure you understand how to design a timber framed house before you go and do a frame inspection by yourself. Again, there are no set rules. You do it the way you find easier. Personally, I like going from top to bottom. I check the rafters and trusses, the connections, tie downs, wall framing, which will include studs, tie down, bracing. I'll make sure the bracing is properly connected to the roof framing, and then I'll head downstairs and check the floor framing and connections. I'll make sure the bracing walls upstairs are properly connected to the floor framing, and all the tie down upstairs continue all the way to the bottom. Then again, you check the wall framing, bracing walls, floor beams, columns, and all the connections. And finally, item number 8, documenting and reporting. Take lots of photos to keep in the company files. Site inspections are a great way for you to learn and see in real life how structures are put together. So always go back to those photos when you can and use them for self-learning. We touched on the reporting part in the beginning of the video. So again, if you're happy with the inspection, write down on the report the items inspected and that they are adequate and approved. Or if you're not happy, state what needs to be fixed. Write your standard sentence that you should have for all type of inspections, because this will help you cover all the important aspects during your structural assessment. And remember, each project has specific requirements, so adapt the checklist accordingly. If you're having trouble reading structural drawings and want to learn how to read residential structural drawings, you can watch this video here. I'll see you next time.